fun one for you today, kids. We are doing a live show, and not just a live show, but this is an actual product review show. So welcome into Record-ology. If you're watching the replay, which I'm guessing you are, because not that many people join right off the bat. So if it is the fact that you're watching the posted version of this show, welcome to Raw Record-ology. My son doing weird things off camera. And you want to wreck your life, walk in front of the camera. Anyway, we are going to do a live show, but it's going to be like an actual Record-ology show. It's going to be like a review. It's going to be like we're going to do the product review. It's like this initially I was setting up for a 1 year later on this unit in front of us. And I was like, you know what? Wouldn't it be actually it wasn't my idea. My wife was like, you know what? Wouldn't it be cool to do it live? And I thought that's a great idea. That's awesome. So people can participate. People can be a part of it. You can ask questions. You know what I mean? I'm shooting this on my phone. So if I'm going to do my best to see the comments. So do please comment and thumbs up. But I'm like, we could do this live. Now, if you're watching the replay, then hit the bell notification so you don't miss this in the future because we do go live. I love doing this stuff. And if you're wondering why people have these cool badges in the chat, it's because they're members of the Record-ology Vinyl Nation, which you too can be a part of. Link in the description below. Now, before we get started, I want to introduce you to a friend of mine. You've heard him on the show. This is, he's very shy. Come on. This is Yoshi the Bird, who's the source of what some people say is the smoke detector battery beeping, the security system beeping. And he's a good guy. He lives, you know, about 5 meters from the camera position. So, you know, this is his space. And, you know, when I come here to start filming, he's like, you're in my space, so I'm going to talk. So you hear that cheeping. This is Yoshi. He's about 13 years old. He's a green cheek canoeer, and he's a sweet boy, except when he rages and decides to rip flesh off of you. So, yeah, kind of temperamental, but he's a good boy, and I thought I would introduce you guys to him. So welcome in, everybody. Welcome in. This will be slightly, probably more than slightly, this will be significantly unpolished and just kind of a different raw view. But we're going to go through all of the functionality of this unit. We're going to review it. I've had it for over a year. It's been on the show a couple of times. And, you know, I have used it outside of the show as well. So we're going to talk through some of that. If you guys have any questions related to this, let me know down in the comments. Or let me, well, yeah, if you're watching the replay, let me know down in the comments. But if you're watching the live, which I hope you are, let me know in the chat. We can interact in real time. So that'll be cool. Let's see. Jonas, welcome in from Lithuania. That is so cool. Love record players that look like that. So do I. Hello from Ireland. That is awesome. Who disc guy? That was Yoshi the Bird. Yeah, Larry, I think you've seen him before. He's been on, it's been a good year since he's been on, but we got a couple animal critters here that, you know, make appearances from time to time. All right, so what we're going to do is take a look at this guy. Now, Electrohome is a brand of CWD, and CWD stands for Circus World Direct, and they don't like it when we talk about, you know, the other brands, but I am going to say that much. So CWD is sort of like modern marketing is to Crosley, and let's see, what are some other analogies? Spectra merchandising is to Studebaker and Jensen. It's sort of like the marketing parent company, which a lot of these brands are just marketing entities at this point. But Electrohome is a storied product. It sort of, from what, this is Canadian, you know, this is a very Canadian brand. But in Canada, this sort of has similar history to like Crosley, I would say. They introduced, I believe, the first television set in that country back in the 50s. So this is the Electrohome Kingston. It's the only record player that Electrohome sells now. They sell a Bluetooth speaker and something else, but they don't have, you know, the product line that they used to, which is a bummer because it's cool. Let's talk about it from a visual standpoint first. So the Kingston is obviously a wooden all-in-one unit, and this is the cherry wood color version of this. And I think it's beautiful. It's very red. I hope some of that's coming across on camera. It is a wooden color, but it is a red wooden color, and it is absolutely gorgeous. It's a veneer. You know, it's not obviously real wood. It's probably a wood board material or like a particle board, and then this is sort of a laminate. But as you can see there, it's got this beautiful wood finish on top, and this is like textured. I mean, it's not just like one of those like images. Like, you've seen like those laminates. In fact, we reviewed one recently where it's just like, you just see like a kind of a digitized low res wood grain image. This is actually very realistic. You know, you could be fooled quite easily into thinking that's real wood because it's textured and it's, you know, very cool. It's a beautiful, beautiful unit. This is also available, or was, and you'll see what I mean in a minute, in black, a wood black color, as well as walnut. So I remember when we were talking to them about this a couple of years ago, a year or two ago, and they're like, well, what color do you want? And I was like, well, I don't know. The black looks pretty cool, but you know, that cherry is just so unique to see that. So, all right, let's see. They should teach Record-ology in school. I like that. I'll be the first teacher. Stopping for comments here. Hello from Germany, Max. Welcome in. That would be cool. Record-ology is a subject. I think there's a lot of stuff that, you know, people miss in, you know, regular primary education that would be interesting to learn. I think YouTube is really great for that, because if you want to learn kind of a quirky thing, like, you can go out there and just get a lot of research, and people are experts in these areas, myself not included, but people that are experts are willing to teach the rest of us and want to learn. Strange question, but do you have any Three Stooges vinyl? That is a great question. I actually do. I have a custom-made 3-inch record that my friend Fardemark made for me. It's actually lathe cut on a 3-inch CD, and it's got a selection of the Three Stooges intro songs throughout the years. I would love... I think there's a picture disc, which would be like holy grail material for me, and anything else Stooges-related, I would love that. That would be really, really cool. Got some Laurel and Hardy on vinyl. That's awesome, Larry. Running fast, slow, or dead on? Oh, and that is a very interesting question. One from VOS Life was running fast. You ever heard of The Caretaker? Yes, I have. Again, Fardemark is really big on that. I think it's bizarre. If you've been around, if you've been with somebody who's gone through dementia, it is an unpleasant yet horrifyingly realistic experience. If you just like kind of the sound of echoey, dissonant music, kind of early stage Caretaker stuff, I do like that. Like, there's, you know, music from another room, kind of sound effects and stuff. And if you've ever been to Hollywood Studios in Disney, they have a phenomenal ride called the Hollywood Tower of Terror, which we just recently visited on a recent trip to Florida a month ago. And they have music playing, like haunting big band music playing kind of in the area. I love that stuff. Absolutely love that stuff. Hello from the Netherlands. That's awesome. Welcome in. Gorgeous looking record player, says Adam. I think so too. Thank you for jumping in there and commenting, guys. Give me a thumbs up if you would, just so YouTube knows we're alive and well. Okay, so Electrohome, the first Electrohome we reviewed was called their Signature, and it kind of looked like this. I liked the dial on that one better. It had like analog dial with like an old school, like a Buick kind of analog tuning dial, and it had this beautiful amber glow. This version, this unit, the Kingston, is kind of simplified and digitized, which, it's okay. I mean, it's not terrible. I think it's absolutely beautiful. But let's go ahead and tour around this. So it's got sort of a padded grill, and from this angle, you guys can see the speakers. It does have remarkably good sound. It is resonant, there is bass, and I think that's really cool. It's got the awesome Electrohome badging on it. Down here, you've got the CD player drawer. It does have a USB, so you can record anything that this plays onto USB at like 128K. That's not like a super high res, but it's an MP3 encoder, which is cool. It's got Bluetooth in, so you can hook up your phone to this and use it as a Bluetooth speaker. Headphone jack, transport controls down here. It even has EQ presets, which we'll look at in a minute. Over here is a source button switch and tuning dial. It's a digital tuner and a button switch. Volume control, this puts it into standby or on. And that's the controls for the front. give me a minute to get back to comments, guys. I got to bounce back and forth. Let's look around the sides of this. Again, that beautiful finish rolls off. I love how the lid just has this curvature in the top. This seems, compared to like Victrola all-in-ones that we've reviewed, this seems to be higher end. I really feel like it's a heavy unit. It feels substantial. You'll notice as we get to the other side, there's no tape deck. I wish they would have put a tape deck in there. They didn't, unfortunately. Here is the back. It's funny, but a lot of people don't like this notch. And they're like, why do they always put a notch in the back? The record sticks out a little bit. Literally, it's just so that it's not quite as deep, so that it can make it a little bit more shallow. In some cases, that enables people to put it on a shelf or something like that. On the back here, we've got obviously the hinges. We've got a vent. We did a couple of videos on this, so if this intrigues you and you want to jump in and you want to see more content about this unit, just search Electrohome on our channel, or specifically Kingston, and you'll find this. Technically, this is the model, what is this, RR75C. This was manufactured in 12 of 2019. And yeah, it's there's an aux in. I don't know why they put everything else on the front, but the aux in's on the back. At least the headphone jack isn't on the back. That's more triggering than anything. It does have a physical on and off switch, as well as that standby switch. I kind of like this touch, a little fabric thing that says since 1907. There is quite a heritage to that brand. It runs on AC power. As you can see, we've got this connector right here. So there's no wall wart, which I think that's a good thing. We've got an FM antenna. So you would just, you know, hang this over the back of the shelf. And that's pretty much all there is to it. The other side is blank. Like I said, there's no cassette deck in this unit. So let's go ahead and power this up, and then I'm going to get caught up on comments. Good morning, by the way. Hope you guys are having a great day. You've watched Tech Moan, and there's no other good YouTube out there. So, this sort of lower level YouTubers doing a live on something. Well, watch that, you know. I get it. Hopefully I can get the breadcrumbs of what's left of an audience out here. So thank you very much for being here. I really appreciate each and every one of you. Okay, let's see here. I've lived with dementia and old Alzheimer's. Very, very serious stuff. I've known loved ones with both of those, and they are no laughing matter. I own stage 2, 3, 4, and 5 on vinyl. That's amazing. It's an interesting project. It really is. Like, I was showing my wife some of the, I was doing a YouTube video, and it was amazing, but not cool in a sense that it was awful and it was unpleasant. But I think it's a great tool probably to teach people, let them experience like that, what that was like. Changing tower to Guardians of the Galaxy. Yes. I think aren't they leaving the Florida one as Hollywood Tower of Terror? Because I know the California Adventure one got switched to the other theming. Sebastian says, I love old comedy and great stuff like that, like Laurel and Hardy and silent things like Charlie Chaplin and Fatty Arbuckle. And love, I keep hitting the wrong button. And love loving you with this stuff. Interesting. That's cool. Welcome in. Sort of reminded me of an older Studebaker record player. Yeah. And this is made by somebody else. I mean, it's the same thing as the Crosley and the Victrola stuff in this category, the all-in-one wooden stuff, where this is an off-the-shelf design from a Chinese company that they brand. I mean, that's the way it is. That isn't to say that all products are like that necessarily, because Crosley and Victrola actually do design on some of their mid and higher-end products. They, you know, spec out different parts in tone arms and cartridges, and then they'll work with some companies in China to build them. But some entry-level stuff, like suitcase players, all-in-ones, are usually just off-the-shelf purchases. So they'll buy these in bulk, have them rebranded, and that's fine. I mean, it is cool. I mean, it's people that just instantly say, oh, it's China, it's junk. You know, it's just, it's ignorant, because that's not correct. There is high-quality stuff coming out of China. Like your iPhone, whatever device you're watching this on is probably from China. So I don't buy into the Chinese equals junk business at all. That being said, obviously that doesn't mean everything is good either. So there is junk that, you know, comes out of everywhere. All right. Wow, got a super chat. Love your channel. Thanks for all your content. Hey, thank you so very much. Super chat, yay. This is available used $500 on Amazon third party. I know, Larry, yep, you beat me to the punch. There's a supply chain thing happening on all record players right now. And a lot of stuff is stuck in the port of Los Angeles. A lot of stuff is stuck in China. The companies that, you know, rent the shipping containers and transport them are charging roughly 30% more than they were a year ago. So there is a major, major issue. If you're wondering why record player prices are going up right now, it's because of that. The logistics prices are through the roof right now. So companies are scrambling and they have to pass the buck because, you know, they're not going to let their precious margins take a hit because of us. That's just the way it is. So this one is on back order. They said February 5th, according to their website, I think they would be back in stock. So it should be back in stock through the website. They're $199 in real life through the website. And then a couple of wise guys on Amazon have a couple and they're trying to, you know, I wouldn't say extort. No, we're not going to say extort. They're charging a higher price than they could otherwise. $199, yeah. $199 was the original price. Tape deck was also not working very good. Yeah, the tape decks are very basic. I made a seminal product cassette deck and ruined my cassettes. Sort of reminded me of my older Studebaker record player. Yeah. So, and yeah, this is an entry-level product. This is the preamble that I have to put at the beginning of every regular video because people will comment. I can say stuff, the sky is blue. And be, well, no, it's not. It's not blue. This guy's not really not blue. You're wrong. You're a moron. And they just won't watch the video. They will not watch the video. So I always put this stuff at the beginning. Before you say, yes, this will wear your vinyl out quicker than a higher-end record player. If it had a tape player, which this one does not, that is a very basic non-Dolby tape player. These are made in mass and not Massachusetts. These are made in mass quantities. And, you know, it's hit or miss. Sometimes you get a good one. Sometimes you get a not so good one. If you don't get a good one, just return it and get a good one. That's all I can say. If they don't do it at that level, then the prices can't be as low as they are. That being said, $199, $200 will get you a good record player. So if you want vinyl, if you're into vinyl for the sound quality and you're into vinyl because of the music, then this is probably not the device for you. Nor would be a suitcase player or any all-in-one. This is for a different type of consumer. This is for somebody who maybe already has a high-end hi-fi setup and wanted to add vinyl to their office, to the living room, to, you know, maybe the garage, although it get really dusty out there. But you know what I mean? Or is a kid that's getting into it for the first time, a teenager that doesn't have speakers, that, you know, their music is on an iPod, that's on an iPhone. They've never done anything physical. It's all streaming. So they don't have speakers and amplifier. This gives you everything because you've got the record player, the radio, the CD player, the Bluetooth, the USB, although I doubt a lot of people are just playing music off of USB these days, and the speakers and the amplifier. Everything's built in. You just plug it in the wall like I'm about to do right now. Just plug it in. Oh, I did already. Okay. Let's plug it in and it's ready to go. Speaking of which, let's turn this thing on already. It does say hello. I like stuff that says hello. This defaulted to the aux position. Because we are live, I am going to be kind of limited on my camera angles. Usually I get down close and zoom in and all this stuff. So we are going to kind of do the wide shot here, but we're going to try to cover everything we would in a normal review video. I want to see if I missed any comments here. Favorite stooge from the Three Stooges or comedy actors? Are you asking me this? Okay. I love Shemp. I really love Shemp. And I know that's not a popular answer to that. Everybody's like, oh, Curly. It's got to be Curly. Curly's great. I love Curly. By the way, Curly's grandson has an amazing YouTube channel. He does a lot of character stuff, a lot of Three Stooges stuff. And I would highly recommend you check that out. Just type in Curly's grandson into YouTube. Really cool guy. His name is Brad Starver. Brad Starver, I think. And he's just a cool guy. But yeah, his grandpa was Curly. Jerome Howard. Okay, so let's start by playing a CD. So this is our source switch. So we're going to go through the list here until we get it to CD. And I know I passed it. I just wanted to do that on camera for you guys. You'll notice this little screw cover is missing. It popped off at some point. It's supposed to look like this one. And let's go ahead and eject the CD drawer. I tried to pick music that won't have any content matches, but you never know. So we'll see if Reader's Digest, the most beautiful romantic waltzes, will be kind to us. So hopefully we will. Even still, I'll probably play it safe and, you know, not play a lot of music and directly without skipping. But check out the sound quality. Keep in mind, too, we're using the vocal mic. So the vocal mic is pointed sideways to what you're seeing. So you're hearing very ambient music. So it's going to be echoey and not a direct feed or anything. And then to skip, let's see here. I remember this having pretty good bass. So the speakers, to my ears, are full. There's low end, there's high end, there's mid range. They're a bit muddy. Obviously, with things kind of crammed in this one space, you're not going to get incredible stereo separation unless you put your head right here. So for a stereo experience, you need to be sitting directly in front of it or use your headphones. Sounds good to me. You may laugh. Oh, you're not going to get content matched with waltz music. I get content matched with... I got content matched with Bert and Ernie's spoken word record from the 70s the other day. They'll go after... And it's a lot of times what they're matching isn't even real. Like, they'll say, oh, you were playing, you know, the Beatles White Album or something, and it's like Bert and Ernie. It's like, okay, clearly your bot is not working right. And I can go through the process of... you know, fighting that, and I have and won in the past, but it takes time, and by that time everybody's watched your video and, you know, you lose out on the ad revenue that we need to support the channel. So it's kind of a catch-22. Sounds good. I mean, this would be great like in a doctor's office or business office, just kind of playing music in the background. This is cool. I've seen these in use too in senior centers, where they allow people to play records and listen to their music. And I think that that's a very noble thing. So, yeah, for that, I think that's another great use case for this. All right, let me get caught up on comments here. By the way, every time I touch the camera, it wiggles a little bit. I apologize, but my tripod mount is the shaft that the mount sticks into is cracking. So it's not as stable. So that makes it kind of wiggly. Okay, we got some great comments coming in here. It's crazy how big records are getting right now. Yes, they are. Yeah, they've outsold CDs this past year. It's continuing to grow. I think people expected it to level off within the last year or two, and it just continues to grow. Absolutely love the Caretaker album. I always treat the subject matter with all my respect. Yeah, absolutely. Love Curly Grandson stuff. Like a drawing through. Oh, that's cool. That's awesome. Do you know Ray Noble? He made a lot of great songs with Al Bowley. Ray Noble, yeah, British band leader. Actually, Glenn Miller, my favorite of all big band leaders, helped set up the Ray Noble Orchestra when he came stateside. He was a band ranger and musician and helped set up a lot of orchestras before he launched his own. I know it is his most popular song, I Love Midnight. Stars and you, cool. You'd be surprised at what they match. Exactly, Larry. Sounds very, very full, but the content matching thing is weird, even on Facebook. Yeah, Facebook is brutal. You can't put up anything on there. Hey, I didn't hear this last live stream, but do you know Vinylize? Yes, I do know Jarrett New, not personally, but I know of his channel. And yeah, he does a great job. You know, him and I have different opinions on a lot of stuff, but I respect him. He gave me a little bit of mentoring when I started my channel in terms of what to expect and some ideas and things. So I definitely appreciate. He's got a great setup. He's got a great shot. Like when he opens up, the lighting is perfect. The background is perfect. I just wish that he did more stuff where he was like showing you the stuff. He's constantly on camera with the picture in picture, which I think would be good for an intro. But then it's like, okay, let's look at the item a little bit more. So, but that's all him. It's his style. I'm not going to criticize it, but that's my opinion. I think does a great job. Same thing with Tecmo, Matt. He was able to chat with him a little bit and get some tips and tricks and things of that nature. We voted him, actually about a year and a half ago, we did a survey, or we did a show where I listed like top favorite, other YouTubers in this space, and, you know, he won the list, which no big surprise. Okay, let's get to the good stuff. Let's look in the top of this unit. And it's got the Electrohome branding up here. I want to point out something. A nice little touch. It has this notch right here. Can you see it? There it is. This nice little thumb notch here, so you can lift it up like that. But I don't know. That's just a small thing, but those kinds of things, I like those little details. It has the one arm here. It locks itself into position when you open it. And then to close it, you have to lift it up and pull it back. And you can kind of see how that works there. So with one motion, you go up and then you brace it and then lower it down. Hardware is great. I think it is really, really good. Okay, so the mechanism is going to be, you know, a familiar type that you see in a lot of all-in-one units. Unlike some, this does have a nearly full-size platter. It's got like sort of the three-quarter size platter. These, let me pull this back. Okay, so you'll see these little markings on the side. Those are not real strobe markings. I had to figure out if you were to put a strobe light on there, how close that is to real, but I would consider that decorative. That's a decorative thing. These inset pieces here are functional. If you put a 7-inch record, it will come to about, actually, let's do that. So take the world's cheapest 45 adapters. This is the worst of the worst, 45. Like, you took 1,000 of these, you'd probably have a penny's worth of plastic, but it gets the job done. So you put that there, 45 adapter, you throw your record on it, and as you can see, let me tilt this forward again, it comes right to that edge there, which gives you leverage to pull the record off, which is actually a nice little touch. It does not need, require, or benefit from a strobe mat, or a platter mat, a slip mat. What am I saying? Okay. Raw, unfiltered Record-ology. I told you guys, it's a live show. There's no editing. I can't make myself sound any less bad than I just really am. It is a hard, rigid plastic surface. Oops. Sliding this off the side of the record, or the side of the table. But it does have these three rubber nubs. Three points of contact is the most stable. So even if the record's a little warped, you know, it won't have any movement on here. It'll be completely flat because of those three rubber nubs. So no record damage is done, etc., etc. But because of that, all of the space past the nubs is essentially decorative because it's not touching the record. There's no support. So that's why some of these, and the suitcase ones included, have a small platter, because anything besides this, you could have like a tripod of three arms holding these nubs up, and that's the only thing that touches the record. That's all you really need to get that same level of support. So this thing, the majority of this surface is doing nobody any good or harm. Let us see here. Let's see if I can get comments updated here. How heavy is it? It is a beast. It is quite heavy. I haven't measured it. Adam says, I know you're a busy man, but can I make a request? Could you compare the 3600 stock and the 3600L with the LP gear upgrade? That's a good idea. I'm not hearing a huge difference, but I want an honest opinion. Yeah, I'd be happy to do that if I can come across the LP gear upgrade, if I can. Yeah, absolutely. If you like cartridge stuff, by the way, stay tuned. We're reviewing a really cool Grado cartridge, finally. Those guys have been on massive back order for the last year and a half or so. So we're finally getting a hold of one. And we're going to do an initial review, and then we're going to review some verses, try this one versus another. They don't like me to do that in the review. They always say, I don't care what the other competition's like. I don't want to, you know, they would like their video. They would like their product reviewed by itself. So we'll do that initially, and then we will go back and do some comparisons. Hello from the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. This unit matches your toaster. You know, that's funny. The toaster's like plastic red, and this is like wooden red. It's kind of funny. On camera, they look closer than they do in person. That's funny. Upper Peninsula of Michigan. That's beautiful country up there. That's God's country up there. Mackinac Island. Beautiful. Jaden says, another question. Do you have the Guardians of the Galaxy on cassette? I do not, but I've got... No, I don't have anything Guardians of the Galaxy. Not anything, but... No, I don't. I know that's popular, but I don't have that. Have you heard of the TIAC W1200 cassette deck? Not off the top of my head. It's likely that I've seen it, but I don't think I've had it. I don't know who TIAC is owned and managed by. I'm not sure. It's never the company. It's not like you call TIAC, hey, TIAC. No. It's going to be like some, you know, marketing firm that bought that name. Okay, so this whole mechanism, I'm going to tilt this down again so we can see it. Oops. This whole mechanism, spring-loaded. It's a belt drive turntable. The motor's here, which isn't a great place for the motor to be because, and again, if you want to see this torn down and what's inside, then check out our other videos on this, but... You want your motor as far away as possible from this because this the tone arm, the stylus, is picking up those vibrations. It's picking up all of those noises. So the worst thing possible is to have the thing that makes noise, the motor, so close to it. So in a higher-end turntable, it'll be over here somewhere. It is belt-driven, so there is some sound isolation. Belt-driven mechanisms are cheaper. That's why they do it. But an additional benefit to that is that you get sound isolation because the belt is pliable and stretchy. It's not going to transmit all of the vibrations and noise from the motor directly to the platter and then in turn the tone arm. So it acts as a buffer. Also, super high-end turntables, you kind of get to mid-range like LP120s and stuff, LP1240s, and you know what else? Crosley C200. You kind of get that $200 to $400 range. And some turntables, especially DJ ones, are obviously direct drive, which are awesome. By the way, stay tuned. We'll be doing some direct drive stuff soon. Not on this show, but in coming shows. But then you get into the super high-end stuff, and they're back to belts. Not for cost, but because of that ability to truly isolate motor noise from the platter. So there you go. But this is an all-in-one unit. This is a transport screw so that when you are traveling, you unscrew this. And that tightens it so it's rigid and doesn't bounce around. But the bounciness is intentional to give it some isolation. So if you're running across the floor, that doesn't, you know, make your record skip as much. It's a three-speed turntable. It's got a cueing lever. And you'll notice this is not a red tip, but it is a classic Chuo Denshi style of ceramic cartridge with, this probably has, let's pop the needle off of here. Just stick your thumb right in the top and it hinges down and then pulls off. This probably has a sapphire tip. Look at my dry hands. Look at that plastic cantilever. That shaft that it's attached to. Cheap, cheap, cheap. And I can see a red tinge to the needle. So yeah, this is going to be that pretty cheap stuff. But it's not going to damage it. A diamond needle will just last longer. Some people swear they can hear a difference with diamond. I don't see how that's possible, but it's harder than a sapphire. So instead of getting like 100 plays or before you need to change it, you'll get more like 1,000. So the 3-speed switch, the auto, does this have auto stop? I think it's got a permanent auto stop. It's got a cueing lever back here. Nice, gentle descent. So let's start by seeing how accurate the speed is. Now this will be a little tricky because I don't have a light source set up to optimize this. So it's going to look kind of blurry to you, but I'll tell you what I see. I'm going to use my Hudson Hi-Fi stroboscopic disc. It's a 2 mil thickness slab of acrylic, just like a platter mat, and it has the strobe markings for all 3 speeds on it. Get a closer look of it there. On the back side, it's got a protractor, alignment protractor, so you can align a cartridge. These are cool. Done a lot of shows with this. This is my go-to device. Some people like to use the app where they stick the phone on there and it shows on there the speed. But if you think about it, the weight that that's causing is not giving you, that's not how much, your record isn't going to weigh as much as that heavy phone spinning on there. So to me, that's going to slow things down, especially on a motor like this where it's not super high end. Not, what am I saying? It's not high end. So this is going to be more accurate because it replicates the weight of a record, the dimensions of a record. If you have a platter with a platter mat, you would take it off and put this on. The only thing that this is going to limit you in terms of accuracy is the fact that you don't have the needle's drag on the record to account for a little bit of slowage. So if it looks a tad bit fast, that can actually be a good thing in the case of, I'm gonna rotate this a little bit, in the case of these mats, because it'll allow for a little bit of slowing once that needle is dragging on there. So I'm switching to vinyl mode on this guy. Okay. And we're gonna lift the tone arm and rotate it over, which will spin it. What speed are we at? We're gonna start at 33. So I'm going to go like this so you guys can see a little better. So right here, it's gonna be these three rings. So this is 60 Hertz power. If you were in the UK, you'd be using the 50 Hertz ring. And three speeds, 33, 45, and 78. So we're gonna start right here. They should look stationary like they do now when this thing is spinning. However, we've got a lot of daylight, and with that daylight, it's not gonna look clear on camera. So I apologize for that in advance. No, it's actually showing it better than I thought. That looks pretty dang good, actually. Huh. I'm surprised. See how it's marching a little bit to the left? That means it's a tad bit fast, but like I said, that's actually about perfect because once that needle hits the record, it's going to slow it down a tab. All right, I'm going to go up to 45. That's the next ring up. Wow, I must have tweaked this because I remember having speed issues on this, so I must have done some work. Yay me, that's really close. And then 78 at the top there, that's still pretty dang fast. Probably, you know why? Because there's pots, there's actual little alignment screws to allow you to adjust that for 33 and 45 because it's a two-speed motor, but you can't adjust 78 oftentimes, so I'm sure that's what happened. Okay, so our speed for 33 and 45 is accurate. That's a good thing. I wasn't planning on playing a 78. You know, a lot of people say, oh, you could not play 78s. That's not okay because it has a microgroove stylus and 78s have a wide groove. So that would be bad. I personally don't believe that it's going to do any damage because this thing tracks so light in comparison to a heavy steel pickup that a 78 was designed for, like ounces versus, you know, mere grams. So even if this is tracking at 5 or 6, stand by, we'll find out for sure. This is still not going to come anywhere near the ounces that, you know, my 1917 Vita Nola with a steel needle would put on those records. So in my mind, again, this is just my own putting two and two together, I can't see how a diamond tracking so light in a wide groove would cause any damage to the diamond or the record. But the sound isn't going to be as good because if you think of a narrow groove, a micro groove, this is a very hideously, you know, simplistic analogy, but this is the groove. We're looking at it sideways. We're down in it. It's like Star Wars. We're going through the Death Star trenches. And here comes the needle, micro groove needle to a micro groove groove, and it fits it perfectly. So we're getting all of that modulation information left and right, up and down. But a wide groove, pew, is like this. We put a narrow micro groove needle in it. As you can tell, we're bottoming out without getting the information on the sides. Very crude, but pretty accurate. That's what is happening. So when you play a record that has a wide groove with a micro groove stylus, you're going to get a lot of noise and very little music. So that you can upgrade the styli to do that, to get a better sound. Okay, let's get caught up on comments. I'm sorry I can't do the comments in real time sometimes. So, by the way, thank you guys for joining. 51 people. That is crazy. Hopefully we're getting some friends from Europe because usually we do our lives in the evening and it's just so late there. Hello from that. Have you heard the TX? That's where we were. Thanks, it's gorgeous here this AM. Yes, that's a beautiful area you're in. Very, very blessed to be there. Gary, keep it simple. Speaking of friends from the UK, I have a few videos on the W1200. I'll have to check that out. That's cool. Opinions on the Godzilla franchise. You know, the only exposure to Godzilla that I had was when we went to Universal. There was a Godzilla versus King Kong ridiculous thing where they're fighting over the tram. That was fun. I would watch that. Would I get my wife to watch that? there's not a chance. You know, there's not enough foot rubs on the planet to compensate for my wife willingly sitting down and watching Godzilla anything. But would I do it? Yeah, I would watch that. I also read information that Tanishin has not manufactured any new cassette mechanisms. Yeah, they're Tanishin clones. The tape decks aren't even real Tanishins. Yep. They're just clones. Germany here. Hey, welcome in. All right, guys. Thank you so much. Keep the comments coming. Chat amongst yourselves. And I'll get in there every once in a while and answer any questions that I can. All right. Speaking of tracking force, we need to make sure that this needle is not going to carve up my records. Gosh, I wouldn't want that. I wouldn't want to put a prize record on my $500, if I were to pay that price, record player, and have it just destroy my records, right? Sorry, I'm drinking what looks like vino, but is actually pomegranate juice. So we're going to use a little stylus tracking force gauge. Comes in this handy dandy, nice, I just threw the weight on the ground, handy dandy leather type of case. This is really important, guys, that you have one of these. Sorry, old man sounds as I bend down. Really important that you have one of these because you'll want to measure the tracking force of your turntable. Here's the gauge itself. $10 or less on Amazon. There's a million different brands. It's the same exact unit. Just get one. They're good to have. Before this, I used a little analog gauge, a little teeter-totter thing, which works okay as well. But if you can afford the $10 versus the $5 for the digital one, I would go with it because it's more precise. And this will tell us how much downforce that needle is going to put on that record before I show you a very cool record that's making its Record-ology debut, by the way. So that'll be fun to show. But yeah, this is like mandatory equipment. So this is Isunao brand and arm load meter. Little rubber feet there. This is the cover. I'm gonna turn it on. You can change what it's measuring. It's gonna default to grams because that's what I always use it for. It's got a nice blue backlit display. See the G in the top right corner? Can you see it? It's kind of hard to see. So what you do is you put it obviously on the platter. And what we're going to want to do in this case is make sure that there's no platter mat. This one doesn't have a platter mat, like we said before, so that's good. Because you'll see the thickness of the actual gauge platform, I guess it is, needs to replicate that thickness of the record so that when the needle touches this, it's going to do so in the same geometry as though there was a record on there. Because if you measure it, oops, that's another thing too. I'm gonna put this in standby. I always do that. But if you were to measure the stylus up here, then it's gonna weigh differently than if it was, you know, if this was not lifted up. So it's important to do that. So what we're gonna do is put it in position here. I'm going to get a better shot, and then I'm going to be condemned to do this with one hand, but that's okay. So you'll see that it says something on the screen, and there's nothing on there. So we need to zero it out, and now you can see it says 0 grams, and we're going to make sure that's as centered as possible, and then we're going to lower the stylus onto the scale. And you're going to be like, well, how in the heck is this tracking at 3.9 grams? Remember when I said these lift shelves hang up a little bit? Push that down, make sure it's out of the way. That'll keep your records from skipping. Oh, and we've pegged it. That's because this thing up here was holding it in the upright position. So now that we've pegged it, you may be saying, well, that's great. You have a 5 gram scale. What are you going to do? You're out of luck. Now, there are 10 gram versions of this and ones that have higher capacity. But the ones that don't come with this little 5 gram weight. And that 5 gram weight is really handy. Gosh, it should be 5, it shouldn't be 4 points. Okay, that 5 gram weight, you'll see there's a 5 on there, allows us to zero this out, and then this will go to -5-ish. Good grief. I guess I need a new scale, that's not that accurate. Okay, it's like a 4.2 gram weight. Anyway, so you'll go negative territory, and what you do is when you add this, you just do the math. So even though it's showing at 0 grams and pushed down that lift shelf, it's holding it up again. It's showing at 1.15.
you know that it's not really 1.19 or whatever it's showing there. You got to add the negative 4. Dot, 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 dot. So basically, you're tracking at about 6 grams. Let's just call it 6.5 grams. So you have to do a little bit of math there, but you get the point. So, you know, everybody's, you know, clutching their chest and saying, my goodness, 6 grams of downforce. Well, that's going to ruin your records. It's going to carve them up. And I'm making everybody else on YouTube's point. Kind of yes and kind of no. First of all, the ceramic cartridges, and by the way, I want to reiterate, ceramic refers to the cartridge material, not the needle. It's not a ceramic needle. So you're not dragging like a coffee cup around on your record. You're dragging a diamond, or in this case, a sapphire, just like a higher-end record player. What the ceramic is it's a ceramic rod, and when you apply mechanical pressure to that ceramic rod, it induces an electrical current. It's called a transducer. And it's the exact same basic idea as a quartz watch. So a quartz watch, you apply current to the quartz, and it gives you a mechanical movement that has a metronome effect that is very accurate. Very similar, you apply mechanical information to the transducer, and it induces electrical current. It's the cheapest way to do this. And ceramic cartridges were popular kind of mainstream mid-range stuff back in the day, but today they serve a great purpose because they can be made for next to nothing. So even though you're spending $500 on this is probably costing them a penny to manufacture, and you can buy the cartridge if you wanted to replace the cartridge for $1.50. I mean, it's super cheap, which is kind of ironic, but even higher end record players will have a, you know, hundreds of dollar unit and then put an Audio Technica 3600 on there, which is a magnetic cartridge, different technology, that, you know, is still a $5, $6, $7 cartridge. So it's always funny how all the money goes into everything but the most important thing. Because at the end of the day, like I always say, you're listening to the cartridge. This thing is spinning it up, but you're listening to the cartridge. It's hugely important. So yeah, with the ceramic, they take 5 to 6 grams of downforce. So we're at 6.5 grams. You know what I mean? I wouldn't put my most prized vinyl on it, but if you're collecting used vinyl, if you're collecting, you know, antique store, thrift store kind of stuff, kids records, you know what I mean? This is perfect for that. It will wear them out faster, but at 6 grams, it's going to wear faster to the point, like within a year, you may notice if you play it every day that it's going to wear a tiny bit noticeably faster, but still be very usable. So again, not for the audiophile, not for the snob, not for the person that's in it for purely sound, but for the person who likes the convenience, the aesthetic, all that stuff, yada, yada, yada. We got a shirt that says yada, 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 by the way. You should totally, totally check that out. This is a great product. Okay, comments. 6.5 ain't bad for ceramic. Yep, heartbreaking at 8+. Yeah, you get 8, 9, 10, then you're in bad territory. There is some data out there that suggests that vinyl records are withstanding or designed to withstand up to 9 grams. I don't know if I would go that high. What is the worst turntable you have used? Wow, that's a great question. We did a show recently on the top seven worst record players, but it was for the Vinyl Nation. So if you want to see that show, join the Vinyl Nation and you'll have access to that. But essentially, if you look at the reviews we've done, we've had really rough reviews on the Walmart turntable. I'm trying to think of what else. There were some rough ones. And some of the names that have done really good products have also produced some really rotten ones as well. Oh, I have a record. Oh, you were saying that I took apart. Yeah, that Victrola V1. Look at that video. That had a rough review, which is partially, I think, well, I'm not going to speculate. It had a rough review. Let's just say that. Excuse me. Oh, that Record Runner. Yeah, that's pretty bad. That was pretty bad. That's like a pushing. Last night, we went over to my mom and dad's house, and she was like, why on earth would anybody want that terrible thing? And I was like, well, it's cool, it's fun. And then I was explaining to her, how it pushed the needle down into the vinyl and just couldn't believe it. But I still think it's cool for what it is. I, you know, just am what I am. I feel what I feel. Hey, Jeremy. Thank you so much for the comments, the super chats, everything. And also, guys, thank you for the moderation. Larry and Jeremy out there with their wrenches helping to moderate. I appreciate that. Five Below record player. That was rough. Excuse me. Sorry for the coughs. I get these acid reflux attacks where I just have these coughing fits for like 5 minutes. Again, usually edited out. The Rock Block, what was the tracking force? It's hard to measure because the whole weight of the device doesn't push down on the record. The cartridge kind of hinges, so it's not as intense, which is good because that would be really bad. Okay, let's listen to a record. I apologize for the coughing, you guys. This is a beautiful, beautiful record. I have not shown this on the show, so you guys are getting an exclusive peek. This is a Phase 4 stereo record. This is like audiophile stuff. London Records, made in England. It's Ted Heath and the orchestra. Phase 4 stereo. If you see these, pick them up. They're good. All right, we're going to go ahead and put this on here. Fingers crossed we won't have any content ID match issues. I'm going to clean our stylus. I love this anti-static Hudson Hi-Fi cleaner. Gently brush there. It's basically like a mascara brush with an anti-static liquid. And you make sure that only the bristles touch, not the steel core. Because that would be bad. That would not be a good thing. And then I've got a carbon fiber brush that we will use to... I guess I can turn it back on now. To clean the record and, you know, make sure there's no static on it, all that good stuff. Okay. Run it off a couple times like that, and then I run it again to the center. And oftentimes these are grounded out, so if you're picking up any static, it'll pop it out on that. So let's go ahead and drop our needle and listen to some vinyl. If we get the needle in the right place. Fun to be able to play some music. So, some good questions in there. Was I ever able to play 16-inch records? I don't know if you saw the recent show where we modified the V1 to be a transcription player. It was moderately successful. I had tracking errors as the further I got in. It's because the arm wasn't long enough. You just can't use a standard arm. You need the long arm to be able to reach the center of that record accurately. So that needs some more work. And yes, I could throw the Rock Block on there, but I'm not going to do that to that precious historic vinyl. No way. Disc washer, stylus brush, Onzo stylus cleaner. You know, we've been talking recently in another comment thread on another video recently about those kind of gel stylus tips or gel stylus cleaners. And we've, you know, used them fairly extensively on this show. But there's concern that as the needle heats up, because it does generate heat with friction as it's going around, that dipping it in those kind of gel cleaners can actually have an issue where it, you know, leaves some residue that is sticky and can then, you know, accumulate dirt and grime in the groove. Bathroom break. It was a cough break, actually. I just want to be one of those YouTubers that can actually, like, leave the camera for, like, 5 minutes and nobody leaves the chat. Not there yet. Never gonna happen. This thing also comes with a remote control, which is still in the wrapper. So I haven't used it very much. Nice, sleek-looking remote. Yoshi's very talkative right now. He loves the music. He loves music. In fact, let me see if I can get him on camera again. If music has a beat, he'll dance to it. So we've got a volume control, EQ presets. Let's see if we can do presets on vinyl. I don't know if you can do that. You can. By the way, bass and treble are at zero, so we're completely neutralized. So more than presets, they're like bass and treble controls, which is cool. Which I can't seem to adjust. It does have a preset button. I wonder what that does. It's probably for CD only. Sounds pretty good, actually. I think it sounds really good. I don't see any damage line. Let's look at that record groove. If you guys watch this, the Rock Block video, it's not hard to spot a damaged record. I don't see any damage. Play some Daft Punk for the bird. He'd probably like that. Look at that, guys. Any damage. Now, there's probably wear happening at a higher rate versus a, you know, a magnetic cartridge that's tracking at 3 grams. I really like the ability to have the cueing lever because my hands are so shaky that it's really nice just to be able to go like that. But again, make sure you push this down. Fixes 99% of skipping issues. After a few years, a pretty common thing is that the damping fluid that is in this piston down here, it's kind of gummy right now. I can feel it kind of sticky, oily. But what happens is that'll dry out, and then these things will start dropping like rocks. And it happens on higher end stuff too. Like my LP3, it's mechanically damped when it drops in automatic mode. But if you just are in manual mode and you flip that back, the thing will go because the damping fluid ran. You can refill it. It can be done, but it's nice and slow when it's new. And then obviously you've got a little lift here that you can, and it's not designed to lift. Like some lifts are, there's actually a little nub under there, but the effective way to do it is to push back And that gives you the leverage you want so you can manually cue a record. Now, I don't know if you noticed this. This cartridge is sitting like this. The back of the gray part there. Can I zoom in all live? Oh, cool. I can zoom in. Okay, let me move this around to a better shot. See how that's sitting down in the back? That shouldn't be doing that. That shouldn't be doing that. That means that the needle, instead of, you know, hitting the record like this, is probably hitting it like that. On this level of a device, on this level of speakers, you're not going to notice it. You know what I mean? You're not going to notice it. But it's not ideal. Let's just say that, okay? I like the fact they put the gray on there. It looks better than the red to me. I like the branding on the top of the head shell. Yeah, it's a laminate. If you watch the replay of this video, I talk about that pretty extensively at the beginning. Yeah, thumbs up, guys. If you can, I appreciate that. Yep, I agree, Larry. MDF with a wood laminate. If I miss any comments, I apologize. What's the best sounding all-in-one suitcase with a ceramic? This is probably up there. It's got good speakers. It's got four speakers on the front of this. Let me back out a little bit so you can see. But this actually has, like, there's a speaker here. So it's two-way speakers, one there and one there. So you get four drivers. Again, the separation isn't great because it's all in this cabinet, but it's got a good, rich sound. You're limited to the sound of the cartridge. A ceramic cartridge, just by its nature, sounds a little more harsh, a little more bright. There's not as great of listen to those distortions on the highs. Hear how it's kind of like sounding on the high ends? That's because the plastic cantilever is not able to be as compliant. It's not able to move back and forth into that groove. So also the Victrola all-in-one, the 6-in-1, the first one we reviewed sounded really good. What's your favorite suitcase? One that's headed to the airport with my luggage. But suitcase player? Oh, the purple suitcase, of course. I like to go a little beyond the purple suitcase myself. Wink, wink. True fans know exactly what I'm saying. Absolutely. But yeah, I hear those tracking. It's not really tracking errors, but compliance issues. Also, it gets worse when it gets to the center because that concentric spiral is tighter. Oops. Whereas out here, it'll sound a little better. The sound quality on the outside of a record is always better than the inside. So it's kind of interesting. Even record labels knowing this would put their hits, oftentimes, the songs they wanted to sound the best on the outside versus the inside, because the record surface effectively speeds up in the middle, and which is not necessarily a bad thing, but because the groove is tighter, the inner groove, outer groove distortion balance changes as the record progresses. So it's kind of an interesting thing there. Hear that sound now? That's a growling dog. But besides that, the record. Most of that's just coming right off of there with no amplification. If this had a magnetic stylus with this amplifier and these speakers, it would sound pretty dang good. And it's not half bad as is. Let's play a 45. This one I won't be able to play hardly anything on because it's not going to be copyright friendly. This is a record back from, I try not to hate. Hate does more damage to the vessel than it does on anything of which you pour it out onto. But I do not like this artist's song that we are going to listen. So of course I'm featuring it on the show. This is Kim Carnes, Miss You Tonight, wrong song. This is Kim Carnes' Betty Davis Eyes on a pretty beat up 45. This is from my dad's collection of records when he was a radio DJ. As you can see, this thing is in rough condition. So that's okay. We're gonna adapt and we're gonna move on and we're gonna listen to this music. I don't know why did I pick this record? I'd have picked one I liked. So we're gonna flip to 45. You'd be surprised how many times I forget to do that. You know what? Let's look at that stylus really quickly. Let us look at that stylus. Let's see. Man, I wish I could get a better shot. What I would love to be able to do is, let me lower the tripod. Sorry guys, this is raw Record-ology. But I want to see how much gunk we accumulated. Yes. Look at that cheap plastic cantilever. Actually, it didn't get that much junk. Andreas says, I'm back to a conical stylus on my Technics. I had to clean my records before every play or the surface noise would drive me nuts. Yes, it's true. You know, an elliptical will really, your records have to be pristine to sound good with an elliptical and newer, because old vinyl gets dry and cracked and those microline cracks become an issue. So, you know, when you have a conical, it's not gonna have that issue as much. So I totally get it. Betty Davis Eyes, really? Just a sound. I can't imagine walking into the studio and it's like, we got this great singer, Kim Carnes, and she sounds like this, and you keep a straight face. But that's my opinion. Just my opinion. All right. Okay, let's clean this needle. This is a great example of why you need to clean your stylus after every play. Look at that. I've never seen that up close like that. That's cool. Okay, all clean. And there's no residue because it's just a liquid. A little bit of fuzz on the top of the clip there, but that's not going to touch the record. You guys can kind of see the red hue to that needle. That's kind of interesting. You know what would be cool? Let's keep this shot. I'm going to try and get like an ultra close-up of this thing. Oh, something fell off. No, let's do it over here because I'm not going to be able to play much of this anyway. All right, ultra close up, you guys. Here we go. Ew. God, no, it's just not good. It's not good. All right, we're going to flip it over. You like it? That's great. I'm all more power to you, but this one comes on the radio, and I'm like, ugh. It's just not my style. It's fun to see this, though. That lift shelf is in the back, holding it up a little bit again. See that? See the angle that the needle is, I'm lifting it up a little bit, but see the angle at which that stylus is touching the record? See how it's kind of pointing back to the right? It shouldn't do that. It should be flat. That's kind of cool though, isn't it? That's closer to a ceramic than you probably ever wanted to be. Here on Record-ology, we bring you all the fun stuff. Okay, so that's pretty much it for the turntable. I mean, it is what it is. It's a typical all-in-one. It gets the job done. I think these are good. They serve their purpose well. I don't have an issue with them. But let's go ahead and back out a little bit. This is least clunky as possible. And we're going to move past the turntable itself and talk about some other features on this stereo system. Kim Carnes is going back into the vault. I can't believe Kim Carnes is in the vault, but I don't know if you guys ever do this. Do you ever look through your records looking for something else and you come across something and you're like, really, I own this? That's just weird. All right, guys. Also, it's probably good I did this before the Super Bowl. I just thought of that too. But let's turn on the radio and see what we can find. I think this only has FM. That's a pretty common thing these days. Okay, so switching sources to Bluetooth. Obviously, we're not going to test that, but you can do that. Okay, oop. What, does it have AM? It does. Cool. I passed it, but it has AM. All right.
asking you today to make Colorado Matters Weekend Edition all of the weekend.
Watching from the UK, welcome in. Good bass. You ever notice that FM radio on these often sounds better than anything else? The reason why, partially, is they use compressors. Not the compressors like digital audio compression compressors, but they actually use sonic compressors that... It's also like the same kind of basic technology they did with the loudness wars with compact discs. But they basically put the whole dynamic range into a narrower bandwidth so that speakers that are limited get those highs and lows that otherwise would be clipped out of the mix.
Siempre hay un deal para silenciar a los ruidosos en McDonald's. Como una Coca-Cola de cualquier tamaño por $1, acompañada de uno de nuestros mandos de $3, como un Hannes.
This is FM, so my friends in the UK, this is not DAB. We don't have DAB radio here. We have something called HD radio. Same basic premise. But unfortunately, unlike DAB, we don't have a lot of specialty cool extra stations. It's just the stations that are FM also have an HD stream. So our car, for example, has an HD radio in it. The good news about HD radio is that you actually get clear reception. So if you get it 100% with no static, no noise. And if you don't get it, it's just gone. There's no like, you know, scratchy, you know, in between zone that you get with analog radio. The downside is the sound quality is much poorer with HD radio than it is with FM because it's a digital bit stream and it's a very low bandwidth one. So high end, if you're listening to music with high end, if you're listening to classical music, jazz music, those hi-hats, cymbals, higher frequencies get totally crushed.
I don't know if they have a, you know, fast, reliable internet.
Let's see what we got here. Yeah, we'll check the AM here in a second. Thank you guys for watching from all over the world. This is great. Yeah, I know I'm used to seeing the red one too. Absolutely.
Perfect. Remember when Moses went to Pharaoh and God told...
This will be a digital tuner. Somebody asked me recently, how can you tell the difference? This kind of stepped knob... this stepped knob makes it harder, but if you have like a smooth, like... I don't want to say analog knob, but if you have a knob that gives you the full control, you'll hear those stations clip in like... Whereas this... This actually might be an analog tuner because you do hear that static. No, it's a digital tuner. When it comes in, it clips in. It doesn't fade in with static. It's like on off on off.
Eyes were there. They're gonna be there again.
This weekend. Yep.
All right, let's go to AM. So I'm gonna flip over to AM. Now, I wonder if I can, like, scan for stations. Do I have, like... You know, the batteries, I think, are just dead in this thing. It's been sitting for a year or two. Sad that it took me that long to figure that out.
Someone that you're attracted to the...
Typical AM.
Then head on over to the tank.
A lot less dynamic range. You guys remember AM stereo? I don't, but I read about it. A lot of dead air in this space. I know there's a talk radio station on 85.
Seeing as we go through different cycles of questions, we had talked about...
Sports radio, talk radio, not a lot of music. Some Christian broadcasting, religious broadcasting, some Spanish language stuff. But yeah, it's cool that it has AM because, you know, that's not something that every, you know... Every system has. A lot of them are going to FM only. All right, you guys. That is pretty much the Electrohome. I'm going to put on... Let's see. I'm going to switch this over to CD one more time. And we're going to put on the world's most beautiful melodies. This is good stuff. Actually, I can work to this kind of music. No problem whatsoever. Put this on in the background. It's peaceful. You don't have to think about it. Shouldn't get me in any kind of content matching issues. Again, if you haven't done so already, hit that thumbs up. That really, really makes a difference.
skip forward a few tracks here.
Favorite portable, Larry. If it's just like a OG suitcase, like a cruiser type of suitcase, the cruiser is good. I think it's better than the Victrola one. And do you guys remember that? How do I say this eloquently? No, I can't say that anyway eloquently. We reviewed some other suitcase players that have been really cool too. But I love the Christmas one probably the most, actually. It's 1x1, I believe, because of the fact that it's Christmas. And I just love that. You know what I mean? It's on par with other suitcase players. And to people that are, you know, already pounding this out in the comments, they're made by different companies. It's not identical to each other. Like, Crosley units aren't identical to Victrolas. They're not all the same. They're not all made by the same company. But in terms of portables as a whole, I love, love, love the Crosley Danzet Jr. If it was three speeds, it would be perfect. I love the Beatles Anthology. By the way, if you like Beatles portables, watch this space. It's been very interesting development going on with the whole Beatles documentary series on Disney Plus, the planned product launch and logistic issues that have caused a lot of headaches for different people. But we will, the log jam may be breaking soon, so we can bring you some cool reviews in that regard. Turn up the music. What is this tune called? This is number, what is this? Number 9, The Boy Next Door. It's pretty music. Glad you guys like it. Yeah, there are a million records of these. Department store in 65. Yeah, I love that stuff. By the way, if you like Muzak type of music, there's a whole cult following of that stuff. There's people collect the Seberg records, the Muzak records. There's streams available online where you can listen to the actual ones. I've collected some of the Kmart background audio. A lot of that's available online, so check that out if you like it. Elevator music, yep, exactly. Here in Canada, we have a bunch of Q radio stations, Q107. Q Meta Station was ready to be broadcast in quad. Oh, interesting. That's cool. AM for a decent 70s, 80s rock station. That's cool. Yeah, I know. The vintage stations are going away. AM stereo was a failure. Yep. HD receivers are rare, yeah. I wouldn't have bought one, but it was in my car. And it automatically goes to HD if it's available. By the way, Michelle, if I didn't say so, welcome in from the UK. Thank you so much. Okay, guys, we've gone 78 minutes. And I am so thankful and blessed to have you here. And, Seberg 1000. You can go to their website and stream it. They had an iOS app where you could stream Seberg music, but they decided not to keep updating that. They were having some issues with the iOS people and or Apple, and they decided to discontinue that. So the iOS Seberg 1000 app is sadly no longer active. However, the Android one is. And if you have TuneIn or any kind of online radio service, you can listen to it on there and their website as well. If you like this stuff, perfect for background, or if you happen to have a business or a restaurant or an elevator that needs some music. Yes, please hit like if you like the video, guys. Thank you so much. That is going to do it for today. Again, if you are watching the replay, I'd invite you to hit that bell notification so next time you don't miss out on the live fun. Hope you enjoyed it anyway, though. For those of you that made time to sit here with me and take a moment out of this hectic world we're living in to just enjoy some music and some interesting tech. I want to say a special thank you. God bless you. If you watch the Super Bowl, I hope you have fun. I hope your team wins, and I hope you're able to spend time with loved ones and friends. If not, I hope you get a break and some downtime to enjoy time with the people that matter. But my friends, that is going to do it for today. So happy record hunting, and we will see you next time.